to yet another episode of GG with the Funk Case. Hello! It's been a while, my friends. I have been away. Thank you once again for joining another eventful episode of GG with Funk Case. So, Funk Case, we are back. So, I've been on tour. It finally happened. We got back. I've been in the USA. I was touring for 3 weeks. And today is going to be a good one. Today we have no guest. Today I wanted to cover something that I get asked a lot and go into a lot of depth. It just feels so special to be back out touring, doing what I do best, making people smile. Playing crazy music for the masses. Today, I want to cover a very important topic. It's a very important topic. Because this is one of the topics I get asked the most. Literally the most. And the topic is... I've been doing this for 12 years. This is the most asked question. I get this daily in my DMs, on every social media. And the question is, how do I make it music? So, obviously what happens when we do this is we play games. So today we are playing... That's right, my friends. We are playing Rocket League. And, oh! And today I don't have a guest, so that can go away. There we go. Finally. Hell yeah. So yeah, so here's my first initial thought with this. Gotta wait for the Illuminati email. Yes, there we go, it's nailed. Alright, where do you start? So people always ask me the same thing, which is... Okay, here's one of the main questions I get, which is... I want to be a DJ, or I want to be a producer. Where do I start? So let's start with the DJ section. How serious are you about being a DJ? How much money do you have? Because obviously, oh great, this is a great start, isn't it? That no match. Great stuff. Where do you start with this stuff, you know, like, and the simple answer is you got to put money into it, as like you do with everything, you've got to put money into it. So you start off with, like, you know, CDJs, for instance. You can buy some CDJs. Oh, that was the worst shot in history, huh? You got to start off with buying CDJs, or you don't even have to. There are some other options. There's things like Serato, which is, you know, like this electronic controller, which links up to your PC. You put the music on your PC. I don't know what's going on here, but we'll do something with it. And you just mix on that. Or if you've got a little bit more money, you can afford a little bit, and you're very serious about it, then put money into a Pioneer controller. Pioneer are kind of like the industry standard when it comes to, you know, DJing. And to be honest, where you're going to be is in the clubs, essentially, is where you want to aim for. So, like, the Pioneer are the CDJ industry standard, so... You really do want to be going for the Pioneers, quite honestly, but there's different ways of doing it. But you can also do it if you have no money at all, really, like that's a center. Ah, close. If you have no money at all, you can run it into different options. You've got apps like Rekordbox, which you can run it like two different players and then play tracks together and then, you know, just kind of mess around with the little mixer on the screen. So people say stuff like, where do I start with producing? Well, this is a huge question. This is a huge question because there's no right or wrong answer. It's kind of like the tool doesn't really matter. Everyone thinks that certain tools matter. You've got Fruity Loops, you've got Reason, you've got Cubase, you've got Ableton, you've got there's so many different options. Honestly, there's so many different options. Logic, if you're a Mac user, and honestly, there's just so many options, but none of them are the wrong option, if that makes sense. YouTube is kind of your one-stop place to learn anything these days. Like, there's so many different people on different skill levels representing and teaching you stuff you need when it comes to trying to get into music. Can I do something cool here? Okay, that was horrendous, sorry. You can also go to producers directly. I mean, there's a lot of producers I know who personally do lessons. People like Bad Clat, Flax, Neonix, and other people like that. So they all do, I've got it. And they all do lessons as well. So you can kind of, you can always gauge, you know, your sound. If you like, say, the Bad Clat's like really forward, aggressive. Oh, damn, I'm not even hitting the ball. If you like his aggressive sound, it's always going to be good to learn. If you like his mixed downs, any of his production styles, excuse me, then he's a good place to go to. So yeah, you kind of just have to fish around and see what you like, what you can gauge. Forums are good places too for information. I've learned a lot from forums. Clear it. I have no boost. He didn't expect it. So yeah, there's a million different places to go to, but yeah. The main question for this stream is, how do I make it in music? Well, but it didn't make him the biggest in the world in one track. You'll never ever get from nothing to everything in one instant jump. You can always get a massive boost. But that is where my first piece of advice stems, which is, it only takes one track. It only takes one track. DJ Snake is a perfect example. If you want to talk about dubstep, you're looking at people like Dr. P, Flux Pavilion, Modestep. There's so many artists that have made one big hit and it's just made them in the scene pretty much almost overnight. You can be a branding masterclass. You can be an absolute beast when it comes to branding and marketing and things like that. But the be all and end all is essentially the music will do the talking. The long answer of how do I make it music? Like, I just say, like, consistency is definitely key. It is definitely key. You have to just keep writing music, and so it's kind of like, if you throw something, eventually it will stick. You know, it's like, it's kind of like that saying. It is true. It really is true. It's like, there's a lot of artists I know who've been around for a while. They've kind of been, you know, underground, and then one hit, whoop, there you go, and suddenly they're involved, you know? And one great example is someone on my label called Versa. It only took him one track for him to be known in the scene, and that was kind of his introduction to the scene, but his next release was essentially what made him who he is, and that's a track called Welcome Tune. It was one track for Versa that really did it for him, you know, like Death Stomp was his our collaboration, which really put his name out there. That was his kind of foot in the door, essentially. And then Welcome Tune was just the one that elevated him from a guy that people knew to a guy that everyone knows. You know, like, he's a household name now, I think, in dubstep at this point. Like, pretty much everyone who's fairly in the know about dubstep knows about Versa. But you can do the long drawn out approach where you just work over and over again, tirelessly throwing tracks at the at the scene, hoping that one will get to you. Which was like the mask, I didn't mean to do. So my friend, so the idea from the mask, I'll go through the story of the mask. The mask, for instance, the day before my first ever Funk Case event, first ever Funk Case set, I was a graffiti artist before Funk Case, and I was actually booked to play at some. I was at a festival the day before. It was a kind of a dress up festival. Oh damn. It was a dress-up festival, and I bought this really cheap suit, which came with a mask at a supermarket, and I left it in my bag. I didn't realize I left it in my bag. My CDs out of my bag to play with, because obviously back then it was CDJs, playing CDs. And I took my CDs out, and my friend saw my mask, and he dared me to wear it, and I said, no, dude, there's no way. I wore it, and it just kind of stuck. I don't know why I continued with it. I don't know what the reason was for it, but it worked for me, because having a brand in music is everything, you know. And having a brand in general is one of the hardest things to be able to try and work out what to have. Like, branding is kind of everything these days, you know. But back in the very early days, the music really just did the talking mostly. Like, it's not like that anymore. You have to be a brand machine. So yeah, I would say if you're going to work out you know, what to do in the scene. You need to have branding. You need to have the music. The music needs to be... So here's another thing as well. I've been a bit of a tangent because I'm trying to explain this while playing games, but your music has to do the talking, but your music has to do the talking in a fresh way. You need to have good branding, but you also need to have music which fits its own agenda. I don't know. I don't really know how to say it. It's more because, like, you know, don't be the same as everyone else when it comes to music. Don't be writing the same stuff. People like Versa, for instance, worked in the scene because he for me is a baby between like two popular styles of dubstep at the same time. So like that style that there's an artist called Marauder. He makes really aggressive. It's almost like the death metal of dubstep kind of thing, but not quite. It's like heavier, more stompy. And then there's another style of music called Riddim, and that is more stripped down, simplified, just bouncy music. And Versa is a perfect meld of the angry stomp and the simplicity. It was two styles that were really popular at the same time. It's pretty genius, really. Like, oh gosh, what am I doing? And he came in at a perfect time. He kind of filled a hole, like, where I feel like Marauder was bringing something a bit different, but he was kind of the only one really doing it right at the time. Needs to be something that you can attach to. Someone can say, yes, you're known for this and this. You're known for this track, but you're also known for this branding. It's a hard process because there is no secret sauce. There really isn't no secret sauce. There's steps you can take, but essentially you have to just do the right steps, which is just in dubstep, for instance, is the music really has to do the talking. You can't be someone who has mediocre music but has an amazing brand, because you'll only get so far with that. It will take you to a point, but you'll only get so far, I feel like, so... Oh, what am I doing? That was the... Oh! Okay, then. Excuse me. But yeah, you have to kind of just... You kind of just have to plod away at it, for instance. Over the times. Oh, okay. Fair enough. That was a weird shot. It came off my butt. There we go. But that was his brand. And that's what people knew him for. That's how you grow. You don't need to have anything like that. Exactly. Marvin in the chat says Rez. Exactly. Rez. What do you know apart from music? What do you know about Rez? First thing. She's got the swirly eyeglasses. Charmian wearing the priest thing. This is what I'm saying. When you take away the element of, you know, music, what is the recognizable part of you? What is the recognizable part of an artist or something, you know, like... And that's essentially where you need to grow your brand, is you need to have a recognizable thing. You need to have something beyond music, because the music will take you, and the music will do most of the talking when it comes to the commercial scene. But when you're trying to grow yourself into a super mega star like Marshmello, for instance, who's just a branding monster, social media is such an important ingredient to the branding side of it as well, man. Like, it's so crazy. Like, social media is just part of it. Like, you've got to have every avenue on music, like, covered. You have to be everything these days. Like, in the old school days, you didn't have to do any of this sort of stuff. So yeah, that's going to be it for this episode. I hope you got some insight on essentially what you can do in music to grow yourself, and how much effort it takes and how much work it's going to be. But your very base point is, and I cannot stress this enough, music. Let the music do the talking. Make your music first. Then worry about branding when you're starting to get yourself a little bit of a name, you know, if that makes sense. So yeah, that's my advice. So I don't know if that helps you in some way. I hope so. I mean, no one told me anything. I learned everything from, like, I didn't come in and go, hey, mask, branding, angry claws, energy on stage, known for doing this and that. Like, I came in and it kind of just happened, and I've learned, and I'm much older, and I'm 35 years old now. Like, I've been around for a long time and I know what works, and this is essentially why I have my own brand, DPMO, and the record label DPMO Records, because I know what it takes to help these guys to get from here to essentially here, you know, like, and then they can go the rest of their way. Like, I can get them in the scene, and I can help them, and I can kind of manage them into making them much more of a viable artist. And then they can fluctuate and do whatever they need to grow their brand, and I'll be there on the side. And I've been doing this with multiple artists, helping them grow. But essentially, you got to do it yourself. You got to know what it is to do it. So, yeah, I hope that you've learned from this, and I hope you can take something away from it. That's going to be me for the episode. We're going to get back again next week, Wednesday, same time, 9 p.m. UK time, whatever that is in your respective parts of the world. That's it for the episode. Thank you guys so much for getting involved. I appreciate all of you for coming in. I hope you learned some stuff. Thank you so much to the North American Collegiate League for hosting this this episode. We're going to be back again same time next week. And yeah. Thank you guys for getting involved. I'll see you guys soon. Have an amazing night. Look after yourselves. And yeah. Stay golden.